As you're being seated, just want to share this morning a little bit of what God has kind of been doing in me. And Pastor Mike, Pastor Chris, they asked if I'd share this week. And you know, there's times in your life when, you know, I've spoken many times, youth ministry and other times, but there's other times in your life where you know, okay, God's been doing something in you that other people need that really can change. I mean, every time you speak, the Word of God changes us. But there's sometimes when you have something God's doing that I really believe in my heart, that if you'll open up your heart this morning, that some of you this morning, you really, God wants to touch you and like change things for that's been going on for years. I'm talking about some of it since you were born and you just thought it was normal and God's, it's not normal. And God wants you to know that he's here this morning. So can we do this morning before we even get started? Can we pray? And can we just ask God right where you're at? Just open up your heart to him and just ask him what he wants to speak to you this morning. I'm going to do the best I can to communicate. We're going to read the word. But what does God have for you this morning? Can we do that? God, we just open up our hearts to you this morning. God, I thank you for every person here, God. It's not coincidence that they're here. It's not by chance. God, every person that is here this morning is here for a specific purpose. And Lord, I thank you that your word brings freedom and it brings life. And so God, we want all that you have for us. God, I just pray this morning that everything that has been put on us as your people that is not of you, God, that you would take that away. That you would reveal to us this morning areas where you want to minister freedom and where you want to minister life. And so God, we just give you praise and glory and honor for this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I've got a phrase that the Holy Spirit has been just, the Lord's been speaking to me all week. It's actually been more than a week. And I'm going to share part of testimony in the middle of today. I'll share a little bit. And then when I get to a certain point, I want to share a little bit. I shared a little bit of this in the offering time a few weeks ago where God really touched me. But since then, God just keeps over and over and over in my spirit. He keeps showing me how important and how much he wants this specific area to be dealt with or to be ministered to in our lives because he loves us. And how much more so with what we're dealing with in our world today. But here's the phrase that's been going over and over in my heart is that God wants to remove the ceiling in your life. See, a ceiling can, I'm not talking about a covering, it keeps us dry. Sometimes a ceiling can hinder us. And what that would be like in your job, sometimes your boss may say, well, we have a ceiling here and you can't go any higher. It'd be like a limitation. It would be a place to where maybe athletically you have a ceiling and that's just as far as you can go because you can't go out of that bound. But see, here with God, he wants to remove ceilings because what I'm finding out in my own life is I don't even know what's all inside of me that's starting to come out because the ceiling God's taken away. And I didn't even know a ceiling was there. Here's the thing this morning. This message is not one to point at you and tell you what you're doing wrong. This message is to encourage you and say, here, God wants you to take some things off and let's see what he wants to do in your life. How many of you know that the world that we live in today needs some people that are unbound, unhindered. Is that a good word? So I want to minister that to you this morning. Now, a couple of things that I found in my life. I came back to the Lord, really started following God when I was 18 years old. So I'm 40, fixing to be 41. So that's 23 years that I've been really just seeking God, seeking his heart. And so everything goes, it's a process. It's a walk with God. It's a marathon, not a sprint. And what I'm finding out in my life is the more I apply God's word to my life, as we're talking about God's word and reading through the Psalms this summer, the more it changes me. And when I came to the Lord and started following him 23 years ago or so, you know, it's been a process. And then now I'm at this place to where I didn't know this was available. Does that make sense? It's kind of like when somebody, you're fixing to have, those of you that have children, people tell you, you can't imagine what it's like to hold that baby the first time. You're like, oh yeah, it's going to be special. You know, it's going to be great. And you know it's going to be good. But when you hold that child, you couldn't understand what that really was going to feel like, even though people were telling you that. Does that make sense? And so God's really been transforming me, and I want to share it with you. But the scriptures I'm going to share with you this morning are scriptures you've heard a million times. I don't have anything here this morning that you haven't already heard. But what God's challenging me is bringing me back to, Breck, when you're reading the Word, focus on the words. Focus on what I'm telling you, not because you've heard it a million times or because that scripture's on your wall and it's in your heart. That's good, but listen to what the scripture's telling you. Some of these scriptures I'm going to read to you are things you've heard a million times, but if you'll listen to the words, God's going to touch you with it this morning. I believe that with all my heart. And so what we're going to talk about this morning is something that most of us don't want to deal with and most of us don't want to talk about, but it's fear. Everybody on the planet deals with fear in some way. Now, I'm not going to necessarily talk about being scared of snakes or being scared of spiders or scared of heights, although all those things can be fruit of the root issues in our hearts. I really feel like God gave me five specific areas, and there's more, but five specific areas that we as believers can deal with, and we don't even realize we're dealing with it. And it's got a ceiling over you, and God wants to take that off here this morning. And so how fear affects us is really, you can look at that up as a medical way. You can look that up in how it affects your physical body, your mental state. And we're going to deal with our spirits this morning, but it's all one thing. And there's an impact in our lives when we deal with fear chronically. It affects your body when you deal with that on a regular basis. But here's what happens, especially as men. We don't want anybody to know we're scared of anything. Because we're supposed to have it all together and we're supposed to be tough and we're supposed to handle things. And God made us that way. He did. If there's a snake in the garage, you're supposed to kill it, not your wife. He made us that way. I don't like snakes, but if there's one in the garage, I'm going to kill it, you know? But God wants you to know as men, I believe that with all my heart, that part of the problem in our country today is that men aren't facing their fears. They're running, they're hiding, they're not taking responsibility, they're taking a back seat. Now, this is not all men, but I believe that if men would take their responsibility in our society today, we would have dads, we would have leaders. We would have people teaching their children what is leading. But because we're scared as men, we sit back. And we're going to talk about that a little bit. But 2 Timothy 1:7, here's one of those scriptures, 2 Timothy 1:7. And I want to read, we're going to touch on some different things. But 2 Timothy 1:7 is one of those scriptures. Here is the, if we could point at one scripture to just latch on to this morning, it's this. And I want to encourage you with this. It says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, listen, and a sound mind. Fear comes at us in our heads first. And then it manifests in our physical body, and it manifests in how we handle ourselves spiritually. But it starts in our head. And he's given us a spirit of, he wants us to be powerful people walking the earth. He wants us to be world changers. That's not a cliche. He wants us to be on the offensive in life, not on the defensive. But if our minds are not sound, then what happens is we're wrestling in here, and we can't hear clearly what we need to do or when we need to do it or how we need to do it. Does that make sense? Okay, and so fear comes real natural to me. Does it come natural to you? Does anybody else, does anybody in here, and fear also would be / worry. Some people even say, oh, I'm a worrier, I just can't help it. Well, that's one of those ceilings that God wants to remove from you today. Because worry and fear limits what God wants to do in us and through us. And even if it's natural, that doesn't mean it's right. The flesh man, there's a lot of things natural. It's natural for me to want to eat junk food. But that doesn't mean it's right, is it? It's the flesh wants to worry. It's just because it's the way it is. And God wants us in our spirits to latch on to what he has for us. So here's the thing I want you to think about. Is there an area of your life that you're sitting in that seat right now and you're saying, you know what, I already know. I already know where I struggle with fear. And right now, you're scared to death because you're thinking about it. Here's the thing about fear. Even if we know we serve a God that could set us free, we're scared to even be free because we don't know what freedom's like. Does that make any sense? We're so used to being bound in fear or worry, anxiety, that we're even scared of what freedom's going to be like. Because what if it's not what we want it to be? And what I want to encourage you with this morning is this. God wants to put the baby in your arms. Because I can stand up here and tell you how wonderful it is in what God's done in me, but I really believe that some of you this morning, God's going to put that baby in your arms. He's going to show you freedom in a way from fear that has controlled your life, and the ceiling's coming off. I really believe that for some of you this morning. And so let's just kind of touch on a few of these if we could, and then we'll go forward. Romans 8:28 says God works all things together for the good, right? So let's touch on that real quick before we dive in. Even if you've dealt with fear your whole life, God works all things together. So if when he sets you free of that fear, he's going to use that for his good. It's not wasted. God wastes nothing. He uses all things and works them together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Each and every one of you in this room are called according to his purpose. So there is no condemnation in operating in fear. You didn't waste it. God's going to use it for his good. Amen? Okay, let's touch on a few of these. I've got five, and we'll see if these apply in any way. I think they do to many of us here. The first one is this. One fear that we struggle with and that God wants to set us free from this morning is the fear of man. What does that mean, Breck? What does it mean to be afraid of man? I just was praying. I was like, God, give me some practical. What does that mean? What does it mean to be scared of people? Because you say, well, I'm not scared of anybody. Nobody's going to hurt me. Fear of man is not just scared somebody's going to physically hurt you. It's, are they saying things that are going to hurt me? Are they, the bad thing about this one is this one causes us to put up walls. Look, Christians, even people that have been walking with the Lord for years, we many times operate in the fear of man and don't even realize it. Because we've been hurt by other Christians. And so because of that, we have to put walls up to protect because we're hurting. Now, the Lord's working on those things, and he's touched areas in our hearts, but here's what you do. If you struggle with the fear of man, you really struggle with controlling people at times. So that's how you would know if you struggle with the fear of man, is you want to control the people around you. You're not going to let anybody in but a certain place, and you know you're going to be real careful about who's coming and when, and you do need to guard your heart. The scripture tells us that. You don't cast your pearls to the swine. We know that. But the point of this is that if you got walls up in your life and you're not letting people see who God's called you to be, then there's an issue there that God wants to touch this morning. This happens a lot with employers. It happens a lot in the business world because you've been hurt by the way they've treated you. They didn't treat you fair. And so therefore you start trying to operate and control and protect and make sure everything's. And how many of you know that when you're trying to control an environment, you're exhausted? Many times the reason why we're tired when we come home from work is because we're exhausted from trying to control the environment. Because we're worried about what's going to happen with the fear of man. So we deal with, it would be a couple of examples would be hard to have any depth in relationships. We're more interested in what other people think of us than what God thinks of us. That's a tough one. Teenagers, that's a tough one. You're going back to school. You're more interested in what people think. It causes us, obviously, to control people. It also causes us to try to not rock the boat. Now listen, let me try to explain this a little bit. Controlling the environment and guarding your heart, it's not just not letting people in. It's also trying to make sure everything stays good and calm because you don't want to have to deal with what would happen on the other side. It's not wanting anything to ever get really dealt with because you know if you do, you're going to have to face those things. And many times what happens is that it causes us to be maybe not operating in who God's called us to be because we're trying really hard to make sure somebody's not going to get upset. You're more worried about somebody getting mad instead of what maybe God would want you to do. That's hard, isn't it? I mean, I'm being real. I mean, this is not something that is easy and it's not something that I've got figured out. But if we're more worried about somebody else getting mad than we are doing what we know is the right thing to do or that something we know God's impressing on our hearts to do, then there's something there. There's a cap there. There's a ceiling there. And God wants to take that off. This morning, we got a good example of this in the Bible, and I'm not going to go through the whole story. Let me paraphrase just a little bit. Y'all have heard this story a jillion times. But King Saul, the Israelites want a king. So they go to Samuel and say, "We want a king." And Samuel says, "No, God's your king." They say, "We want a king. No, give us a king." So Samuel says, okay, so God points out Saul. Now, here's the thing about the Bible. Do you ever find people that fail in the Bible and you almost get judgmental? Does anybody else ever do that? You're like, Saul, what was Saul doing? You know, why would he do that? Do you ever do that? You know, I read this story and God's like, yeah, because you're the same way. You're the same way. It's easy to be critical of people when they fail when I'm failing all the time. And I got Jesus. You know, that's what's so good. I can go right to the Lord and say, forgive me. But you know, Saul was called by God. He was anointed by God to fulfill a purpose. And when Samuel anoints him as king over Israel, he pours oil over his head. He gives him specific instructions to go to a place for 7 days and wait on him. As he's in between the time where he's anointed king and he's going to the place to wait on Samuel, the man of God, Samuel tells him, you're going to be anointed, you're going to prophesy, and the Spirit of God is going to come on you. And the Spirit of God comes on Samuel. God called Samuel Saul to do something. And then in between, he gives him instructions. He goes to the place he tells him to wait on Samuel. And we know the story, but what happens is Samuel is a little late getting there. He's supposed to be there in 7 days, and it says in there that Saul said, I waited for you 7 days, and you didn't come. Well, while he's waiting, the Philistines, we've heard them before, they're coming to fight, right? They want to take out the Israelites, so they're coming to attack Saul and the Israelites. Well, the men get scared, and so they start hiding. So if you're the king, and your men who are supposed to be with you are fixing to go to war, and your guys start hiding, that would be a little scary, wouldn't it? The Philistines had like 3,000 men and chariots and horses, and so they're hiding. So what does Saul do? Because he's scared of the environment, he begins to offer the sacrifices to the Lord when God, that wasn't the way it worked then. Samuel was supposed to do that. And so he starts offering the sacrifices because he's scared of what's going to happen. It says that the men were quaking in fear. So fear is causing Saul to operate in a position that he wasn't supposed to be operating in. He wasn't in the place he was supposed to be. So Samuel comes, says, you did it wrong. You messed up. He rebukes him. And so Saul kind of makes his excuses and kind of goes through the thing. And then the story we all know, if you flip over into chapter 15, Samuel gives Saul another chance. Maybe God's giving him another chance. I don't know. But he tells him to go take out the Amalekites. We've heard this story before. But as he tells him to go to the Amalekites, he says, destroy everything, all of it. Because they had come against God's people previous times. And so what does Saul do? He goes and he destroys everything except the king. He wants the trophy. He saves the king, and he doesn't kill the prime livestock, the first livestock. And so what does Samuel do? He shows up and he says, Saul, did you do what I asked you to do? And Saul says, oh yeah, I did it. I did it. I did it. He said, well, why do I hear the sheep? And why do I hear all these animals? And what's going on? And Saul makes excuses again. Do we make excuses sometimes? I know I do. And Saul said, and finally Saul says, you're right. I messed up. And this right here, this one verse, I want to read to you. It says, Saul finally gets to a place to where he's going to repent. And it's 1 Samuel 15, 30. He says, I have sinned, but please honor me before the elders of my people and before Israel. Come back with me so that I may worship the Lord your God. He wanted to be honored before the men. And actually right before that, he even told Samuel, I was scared because the men wanted to keep these things. Saul failed as a king. And you can say it was because he was disobedient. But I believe that the root issue in Saul's life is he was scared of men. He feared men more than he feared God. And that's something that's very difficult to face if we deal with that. But God wants to remove that this morning from our hearts and our lives. Amen? So the first one would be fear of man. The second one would be, that I have this morning for you, it would be fear of failure. Fear of failure. Now, I know I touched on men, but here's one that as men, we struggle with a lot. Who likes to strike out? Nobody. Who wants to mess up and fail? Nobody. But how many of you know that no matter what, we're going to mess up and we're going to fail at times? But God wants us to face those things. He wants us to come and say, you know what? I'm going to still go for it. Can I give an example of this would be... my son. I'll give you an example with Micah. Last year, during baseball season, he was scared to death that he was going to fail when he was batting. And here's what he would do, literally. He was so scared he was going to fail. He wasn't scared that the ball was going to hit him. He was so scared he was going to strike out. He would be running out of the batter's box when he was swinging at the third strike. His body was operating strictly out of fear. And as we dug and as we got into it, we figured out he wasn't scared of the ball. He's never been scared of the ball. He was scared that he was going to strike out. If you're scared you're going to strike out, what's going to happen a lot of the time? You're going to strike out a lot of the time. And his physical body was manifesting what was going on in his head before it even happened. Literally, his feet would already be out of the batter's box as he's swinging on the third strike because he was scared to strike out. Now that sounds silly. But in our lives, how many times do we not attempt to do something for God, or not attempt to pray for somebody, or not attempt to just do what God would have us to do in our workplace, in our schools, in our environments, because we're scared we're going to miss it? This area is one as men that is very, very easy to just mask and just pretend like it's no big deal. But where you can know you struggle with this is if you try to control your environment. What that means is that you're not going to rock, you're just going to sit back, you're going to let other people take the lead in your household or maybe at your work. But you sit back and you let somebody else have it. You let somebody else take it because you're not qualified. How many of you know none of us are qualified Where does that word come from? Yeah, we can go to school to become qualified to do a profession. But spiritually, how do we become qualified? It's just walking with God every day. Listen, you have something. You can lead somebody where you've been. And you're further along than other people. Does that make sense? You can take them where you've been. You can encourage them to follow the route you've taken. Are you where you want to be? Nope, I'm not either. But I can encourage people to follow the Lord to the place to where I am. I can encourage that with them. But if I'm scared that I'm going to miss it, or that they're going to think I'm weird, or that I'm not going to, what if I pray for them and God doesn't answer? Well, what if he does? You know, I mean, I always struggle with this. Always. Spiritually, I struggle with this. Because I didn't want people to think I was some crazy religious nut. And so many times God may impress something on my heart and I wouldn't maybe follow through with it because it was a little different. I really respect people that they just go for it. And God's challenging me personally to just go for it. And so I've started doing that. I started just asking if the door even, I used to wait, if the door was open, like if I was talking to somebody and the door was wide open, I'd go through it. I've been following God a long time. I love him. I'd go through the door and I'd share the gospel with them. But what God's telling me is, Breck, you got to knock on those doors sometimes. Shake the doorknob, you know? But I was always scared if I shake the doorknob, somebody was going to think I was breaking in. If they open the door, I'm just going to give them something. I'm just going to pray for them. I'm going to do what the Lord is. You know, I want to be everything God's called me to be. And as he has begun to speak this to me, it's really transformed. The ceiling's off. And I'm in a place in my life now to where, you're right, I'm going to pray. I'll pray for people when it's on my heart. And sometimes they're not going to get healed. And sometimes they're not going to feel it. And sometimes they're not. But you know what? I'm just going to do what God leads me to do. And God just wants you to do what he wants you to do. And just because the results don't match what we think is success, that doesn't mean it wasn't success. Success is not based upon always results. Success is based upon you stepping out and allowing God to use you. Does that make sense? So fear of failure is a big one. Here's another, the parable of the talents. We don't want to bury what God's given us. Let me encourage some of you, and I mean this sincerely. Some of you in this room have things to offer that you're sitting on it. And God wants you to know, he wants you to allow his presence and his spirit to flow through those areas. Don't bury your talents. You're not prideful to live for God. It's not pride to follow him. If you're seeking him every day and you're in his word, the God will deal with pride. I promise. But would you rather err on the side of being on the offensive and being who God's called you to be, or err on the side of sitting back because you're worried you may offend somebody or you're worried you may look prideful? The devil has used that against me for years. That if you do something a certain way, people are going to think you're prideful. He always told me that, and that was a lie. And I thought I was being humble, and what I was doing, I was sitting on my talent. And some of you are sitting on your talents. And God's like, come on, let's go. Dig that stuff up, let's go. Because he hadn't come yet and said, all right, what have you done with them? If you're sitting in that chair right now, God is not asking you back for your talents yet. You're going to face him one day and he will. But right now he's saying, use those things, let's go. And here's the exciting thing. Many times we don't even know all the talents he's given us. God's going to show you things that you didn't even know were in you. And there is nothing greater than walking in what God's created you to be. Amen? So, fear of failure. This is a big one. So you try to control your environment. Okay, here's the one that God touched me in church a few weeks ago, and I want to share this. I want to share my testimony here. I kind of did it during the offering. If you heard it, I'm sorry. Just have to hear it again. Fear of death or fear of missing out. I was not scared to die. Like, I wasn't scared I was going to die. What my struggle has always been is I was scared I was going to miss out. And what I mean by that is I want to walk my daughters down the aisle. I want to impart into my kids everything I'm supposed to impart into my kids. I want to be the dad I'm supposed to be, the husband I'm supposed to be. I want to minister on the earth the way I'm supposed to minister. And I guess all my life I dealt with this. I can't even think back a time when I didn't deal with this. I always just thought I wasn't going to live long. I mean, I just always kind of had it in the back of my head. And so what would happen is I would always struggle with any kind of planning just freaks me out. I'm telling you, if you put a calendar in front of me and say, oh, we're going to plan out this year, I'll break out in hives. I'm telling you, I'm going to break out in hives. I'm going to start sweating, and I may hyperventilate. I hate planning out like a year in advance. Is just give me today, tomorrow. I may can plan to Wednesday, but after Wednesday, just we'll deal with that then. Is anybody else like that? But part of that is because I always felt like I just wasn't gonna be here long. And so it was a tormenting thing. And it wouldn't happen all the time. If you deal with this, you understand this. You'll have times in your life where you're good. You mean you don't have any problems. You're rocking along, purpose, vision, life, you know. But you're going to have times where all of a sudden you start hearing that in your ear. And it may come because you got an ache in your chest. Maybe you even get a cramp in your chest. Or maybe you just don't breathe good. Or something catches. Or it can be that you start forgetting things. You may have a day where you don't remember a whole lot. You think, oh gosh, I got Alzheimer's. It's coming. And here's the thing. We think it's silly, but here's what I'm finding out. I do devotions with the William Carey baseball team in the spring and in the fall. And last spring, God challenged me. Now, this is before God touched me in church. There's something to learn from that. But God challenged me to share this in front of this baseball team. And I'm like, Lord, you want me to tell all these men, these boys, that I'm scared of dying? And I'm supposed to be up here being a light and sharing the truth with them and telling them about Jesus when a lot of them don't even know you? You want me to tell them I'm scared to die? And the Lord said, yeah, I want you to do it. So I stood up in front of these guys. Most of them aren't believers. Stood up in front of the coaches. This was my old college baseball coach. And I just told them. I said, you need to know that just because I'm up here sharing with you every week, I don't have it all together. And I'm not perfect. And yeah, I love Jesus, and I'm going to do everything in my life for him, but I'm struggling in an area of my life, and here's what it is. And I told them. And when I got done, I was a little, I mean, it's just not comfortable. You know, I mean, really. Because if you don't struggle with that, that can sound silly. But when I got done, the baseball team goes out in the field to warm up like they always do. There's an assistant coach that I played with there back in the 90s. There's another assistant coach that's younger than we are by about 10 years. He's about 30. And then the head coach is in his probably 60s. All three of them came to me separately and said, I deal with the same thing. All three of them. And one of them said, it's because my girls are little and I'm afraid I won't get to walk them down the aisle. And that's exactly the way I felt. As men, I think there's a lot of men that deal with it. The more I talk to people, the more I find out that a lot of men deal with this. Women maybe as well. So I share that to William Carey. Well, about a month ago, I should have it documented, but we're in worship here about a month ago, maybe 5-6 weeks ago. And I wasn't thinking about this issue in my heart, okay? I wasn't thinking at that time, but I did have an area where I kept having this burning sensation in my chest. And it went on about 6 weeks. And I thought, what is this burning sensation in my chest, you know? Well, every once in a while, it'd be like the devil would be like, yeah, you got cancer. Or you got whatever. And I'm like, I ain't got cancer. But then, you know, it was hindering me. And look, the spirit of fear, whatever way it controls you, it torments you. I mean, it torments you. Because it's not a constant, but it's like that little chirp in your ear. And you're trying to be who God's called you to be, and it's chirping in your ear. And now it makes me mad. But I'm sitting in service, and I've got this, and the Lord speaks a scripture to me. One of the most common scriptures in the whole Bible. For I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you. Listen to the words. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. And then when I got to this part in the scripture, it was just like God's presence was so real. Plans to give you a hope and a future. And I'm sitting there, and God just ministers that to me, and I just latched on to it. I mean, I was like, Lord, I mean, it's one of them times where God's word just, but I still had the burning in my chest. The next Sunday, I'm sitting in the same spot. I'm not thinking about the scripture. I'm not thinking about the burning in my chest. I'm not thinking about anything. I'm just worshiping. And God just took it. I'm talking about just boom, gone. Not just the burning in my chest, but like that fear that's always been there, it's gone. I mean, it's gone. And it's not a matter of, will I deal with fear anymore? Sure. But that tormenting thing, that ceiling, it's gone. And so what I'm finding is, I like this. I don't like the ceiling. Because here's the thing, I love Jesus. I mean, I'm telling you, I love the Lord. But now, I can freely give that more to people. And you know what? Sometimes I'm going to miss it. But I don't care. I'm still going to give it to them. I mean, I'm giving it. One area of fear, my main one was fear of death or missing out. But what I'm finding is they're all laced together. Because now what happens is I realize, you know what? I was scared to fail as well. And now I'm not scared. I mean, I don't want to fail. I don't want to strike out. But I'm not nearly worried about striking out as I am. I'm going to hit it over the fence. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to let God use me to do whatever he wants to do, however he wants to do it. And I'm not worried about it anymore. I used to have people all the time tell me, why do you apologize when you preach? That's happened like a bunch. People would say, when you share, you apologize. You need to quit apologizing. You know why I apologize? Because I was scared I was going to say something wrong. I was scared I wasn't going to say the right scripture. I was scared I was going to say the wrong word, or I was going to say I was going to preach heresy, or I was going to, you know, I was always scared that I was going to mess up. And yeah, I need to study to show myself approved. But you know what? I'm not nearly as worried about missing it as much as I am about let's hit it. And now my feet aren't coming out of the batter's box, and all of a sudden I'm figuring out, you know what, God, you got a little, there's more here. And what I'm telling you this morning, the testimonies in our lives encourages us towards freedom. And what I'm telling you is God this morning wants to bring freedom in your life that way. He really does. So it could be fear of death, fear of missing out. A big one here would be the next one, number four, the next one would be fear of abandonment. You know, Satan doesn't play fair. We all know that, right? Satan doesn't play fair. Some of these fears get put on us by other people. Your mom and your dad, or one of them left when you were a kid. They abandoned you. I have a friend that is a missionary that I respect in the Lord as much as anybody walking the planet. He lays his life down for the gospel, not in comfort, but in ministry on the other side of the world. And he has struggled with the fear of abandonment because he's never had a dad in his life. And the one dad he thought he had in his life, when his mom remarried, disappeared and hid from him. And he found out he was in the same city with him all the time, and he just was gone. And he has dealt with that abandonment to the point where now he's realizing he's been a missionary for, I think, 20 years. And God's working on his heart now to say, you're a son, not a servant. See, fear makes us be a slave. We're a slave. We do it because we have to. A son does it because they get to. And he's realizing in his life that he's been operating under the slave mentality when God wants him to know, you're accepted by me. So if you deal with the fear of abandonment, it could cause you to make poor decisions. This is many times why people deal with illicit relationships, hopping from relationship to relationship to relationship. It's because they don't want to be alone. And so they smother the people that show interest in their lives. They just latch on and just suck the life out of them because they don't want to be alone and they don't want to be abandoned again. And what it does is then it reciprocates, doesn't it? And then people reject them and abandon them and they can't handle it. I've got a close friend of mine I met when he was 15 years old. Dad wasn't involved in his life. Coached him in baseball. Started spending time with him. He's dealt with this issue his whole life. And many people just couldn't stand to be around him because literally he would suck the life out of you. He'll tell you, God, I was bad, wasn't I? And it's been 20 years. He's 35 years old today. And the growth in his life. Now, has he got it all figured out? Nope, and I don't either. But the growth in his life, and now I can be on the phone with him 5 minutes, where used to, you couldn't get off the phone. Does anybody have anybody like that? You're like, I can't get off the phone with this person, and I love them, but I ain't calling them because I can't get off the phone. That's somebody dealing with that particular issue usually. Now I can talk to him 5 minutes or 2 minutes instead of 25 minutes. And what's happening is our relationship's closer. Because he knows I'm not going anywhere, and he's becoming more and more confident in who God's called him to be. And the fruit of his life now, the ceiling's starting to come off. And now he's starting to operate in purpose. And now he's got this new job. And this new job, he didn't realize he could do this. And the next thing you know, he's being real successful in a profession that he never thought he would be able to do. And God's blessing him. And it's because he's realized he's accepted. And that God's not leaving him. And these other people aren't leaving him. And that he can do this. And so if you're dealing with that one, Hebrews 13:5 says, God says, never will I leave you and never will I forsake you. Never. God told Joshua, as I was with Moses, so I'll be with you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Romans 8:35-37. Can we put that on the screen? Can I just take just a second to touch on our society today is so confused. Is that a good word? In so many ways. And I don't know about you, but if you talk to people on a regular basis, you hear that victim mentality. It's just, and I'm not talking about ethnicity. I'm talking about just as a whole. There's this place many times if you start talking to people, it's just not good. When God's told us, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. We've heard that how many thousand times? But listen, if you deal with abandonment, you are more than a conqueror through Christ. And yeah, your dad may have left when you were a kid, but God is your father, and he wants you to know you're accepted. And you don't have to be a victim. You can be an overcomer, and he wants to use you. He wants to take off the ceiling, and he wants you to begin to minister to people instead of always needing people to minister to you. And I'm not bashing anybody. I'm just saying that's an area of our lives that many times hinders us. Fear of abandonment. Last one. I'll finish up. Here was another one that was tied in for me, and the fifth one would be, it would be fear of the unknown. This would be somebody that really struggles with fear of bad weather. Reagan? I love my daughter. She just doesn't like bad weather. That's okay. Bad weather nobody likes bad weather. I don't like it either. A few weeks ago or months ago, we had a tornado kind of come right through our kind of front yard, and we're in the bathtub, and it was the real deal, you know. I looked out the front window, and it's pitch black, and I'm like, oh, my goodness, and it tore. I didn't like that, and I was afraid, too. But I always struggled with this area as well, and I didn't realize it was tied into that. Do you ever lay on your pillow at night, and you're going to bed, and you've said your prayers? You're fixing to go to sleep. And then you get this feeling that comes over you that says, what if? This spirit of fear is birthed in the what if. And then your mind starts. And then you take it and you say, well, what if somebody breaks in my house? You know, can I, what if that tornado does? What if my job does fail? What if all those things are real issues? But what they do is they hinder us from being who God's called us to be, because we're so worried about what could happen that we're not walking in who we're called to be right now. It takes the joy out of the journey. See, walking with God is supposed to be fun, not easy all the time, but it's joyful to walk with God and to allow Him to minister to us and through us and to get to be used by Him and all those things. That's good. But if we're worried about the what ifs, if it's always the what if, what if I don't have enough money? What if I don't? This one happens a lot financially. The reason why many of us struggle with our giving is because we're, what if I don't have enough? What if? But you know, God's not a God of lack. And the offering's been taken up. I'm not even on staff. I'm not asking for money. I'm just saying that as human beings, many times we struggle with this. And we say, well, what if this happens? What if that happens? And God wants you to know this morning that He wants to take that away. If you struggle with the fear of the unknown, then Psalm 23 is a really good psalm for you to focus on. I told you these are scriptures you've heard a million times. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. How many of you want quiet in your head when you're going to bed? He restores my soul. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for His name's sake. So you know what? I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't. I can't tell you what's going to happen in our country, in the election, in finances. I can't tell you all that. But I know this. He guides us. He leads us. He directs us. And if the ceiling's off, we can be who God's called us to be. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. If you're not scared of the unknown, then you can sit at the table with your enemies. You can, because you know God's with you no matter what happens. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Look, you can latch on to that. I asked the Lord this morning before I got here, I said, Lord, is there any specific thing? I know I'm supposed to share about fear, but is there anything specific you want your people to hear? And I heard one word or one phrase. He wants victory for your life. I heard victory. Satan builds a case of fear against you your whole life. Some of you have dealt with these things your whole life. You may be, I don't care if you're 65 years old, 75 years old, or 10 years old. Satan has worked years many times to build something. Some of these fear issues are passed down through your generational. Your mama dealt with fear. Your grandmama dealt with fear. Your great-grandmother dealt with fear. And now you're dealing with the same issue. Some of these issues Satan's been working on for like decades. You know what? God brings victory in just seconds. What Jesus did can take that stuff away. He can remove the ceiling Satan's been building for years that fast. The God we serve is King Jesus. He is the Lord. Satan can do all kind of things to try to stop us, but you know what? If we come to him, he is King Jesus. Faith comes from hearing the word of God, but you know where else faith comes? It's from walking with him every day. You ever have somebody say, I just can't believe that that's real, and they want to make an argument or want to make a case? You can't argue with experience. You can't argue with time God met me at the altar. You can't argue with me sitting at that chair and God touching me that way. I may not can explain it to you or you can understand it, but you can't argue with that. And so when they want to try to go at me at that, I'm just going to keep going, Lord, here I am. I'll do whatever I need to do. It's never been that way with me, is what I'm trying to tell you. And that's what God wants to do in you. Freedom. I'll finish with this. If you've ever played, I know some, this is football, okay? I played football in high school. I didn't have a brother, so I never got in like fist fight. I've never been in a fight in my life. True story. I've never been in a fist fight my whole life. And everybody liked me. I wasn't cowered back or whatever. But in high school, let me give a little disclaimer. When I was in high school, I went to Oak Grove. Oak Grove now is like football powerhouse, right? Play for the state championship. Football then was just what we did until baseball started. I'm serious. I'm talking about halftime when the band got done playing, everybody left. That's a true story. Second half, of course, we were getting beat by 30 a lot of times, but second half, it was just like our parents up there, go, John, you know, go. Nobody else. But high school football taught me a lot. At that time, I was about 210 pounds, and so I played middle linebacker because I couldn't run fast, but all I had to do was stick my head in these two holes. And I got a hard head, and I could do that. I got run over a lot, too. But what football taught me is that freedom is letting loose, okay? If you're scared, my dad told me as a young man, my dad was a good football player. He played at Southern. But he told me, if you're scared on the football field, you're going to get hurt. But if you'll cut it loose and you'll go, your chances of getting hurt are a lot. And when he told me that, I was like, he's right. So what I started doing is, now my neck bothers me still today. True story. My only problem physically. But what I started doing is I said, you know what? I'm just going to cut it loose. And I'm not a loud person. I'm not an aggressive person. But on the football field, I could do that. And I love to scream. I'd love to just hit somebody and then just in a not good way. This was before I came to the Lord. I love to just stand over them and just scream. Not I killed you or nothing, but just that feeling. Because it was freeing. I didn't have to worry about getting in trouble. Wasn't nobody going to arrest me. I could run them over if I did, not all the time. But if I ran them over, I could run them over, and they would be cheering for me. It was good. Jesus wants you to be free spiritually. If you're scared that you're going to fail, if you're fearful that you're going to fail, if you're fearful of man, if you're fearful of dying, if you're fearful of the unknown, then what's happening is the ball snapped, and instead of filling the hole and making the tackle, and if you do that, guess what? Touchdown. And what happens is we start losing confidence. Now, we love God, and we come to church, and we're going to worship him, and there's no doubt we're going to heaven. But what I'm trying to encourage you with today is God wants to remove the ceiling so that you can begin to fill the holes, so that you can begin to make tackles, so that you can begin to be free to do all God wants you to do for you. So simple thing here. Jacob, if you come back up. Simple thing. what I found in my life through this process, and I've got to spend time, since this happened to me about 5-6 weeks ago, I've got to spend time with a couple of people who I have found to be dealing with fear. Some in ways that, like, literally they just couldn't operate. Have you ever dealt with fear to the point you just couldn't operate? Like, you couldn't think right. You couldn't function. Couldn't do your job. Have you ever dealt with it like that? I've been spending time with some people, and what I'm finding is that God wants them to enjoy Him more. I want it to be that simple. Listen, Jesus died on the cross for your sins, on the cross for my sins, to bring freedom in our hearts to enjoy Him. If we're enjoying Him, what are we going to do with it? We're going to give it away. If we're giving the love of God to other people, what's going to happen? It's His loving kindness that leads people to repentance. It's not pointing a finger. It's not debating. It's not. But you know what? I can love people aggressively. I can love somebody aggressively, and I was always scared to love people aggressively. I know that kind of doesn't make sense, but I think you understand what I'm saying. And God wants you this morning to remove ceiling, and He wants you to love people aggressively. Just enjoy Him and go for it. Now here, this is a good example. Every time I've ever spoke, especially in the main service like this, youth maybe not so much, I was always scared to do an altar call. Because I was always scared of, like, Lord, what if I miss it? What if they're not supposed to come down front? What if nobody's supposed to come? And what if then nobody comes? And I'm just standing up there, and then I just miss the whole thing. And, like, that's just not there anymore. Because here's the thing. There's a simple process. Coming to the altar is not a religious duty. Coming to the altar is bringing our fear. And we're laying it at the feet of Jesus. He is the answer. Breck, Daniell is not the answer. Pastor Mike is not the answer. Jesus is the answer. And He will take that which you bring to His feet. And you know what your fear is when you lay it at the feet of Jesus? It's an offering. Because He paid the price for that. When my children bring me their fear and I can take it from them, that is a wonderful thing. Jesus paid the price on that cross, not just for sin so that we can go to heaven, but for freedom so that we can love other people. And so this morning, this is what I'd like to do. I'd like everybody just to right there where you're at, just open up your heart to the Lord. And we're gonna take just a second, and we're gonna let Jacob play. And then if you've got an area in your life that we've touched on this morning, listen. If you're 65 years old, do not let fear keep you from bringing what you have to the altar and give it to God. Not because you're a sinner, not because you messed up, not because something's wrong with you, but because you just want to give it to Him. And God's shown you an area in your life where fear has controlled you, it's hindered you, it's put a ceiling over your ministry, who God's called you to be, where you're supposed to be. And you have tried to control people, control environments, control everything in your life, and it's kept you from being all God's called you to be. I know it's scary, but if you'll bring it to God this morning, He's going to take it from you. You're going to get to hold the baby. And so right now, as we just prepare your hearts right there before the Lord, if there is an area of fear that you're dealing with, I'm going to get you to just come to the altar, and we're going to pray a simple prayer together. And we're going to give that to God. And He's going to take it. He's going to take it. So if you've got an area of fear that you're dealing with, have dealt with, go ahead and come. Go ahead and come. I was talking to somebody. It just may be a simple little thing. Just come. If you deal with any of those areas, just come. We're going to give it to Jesus. He's going to take it. This is what He wants. This isn't what Breck wants. This is what Jesus wants. He's going to take it this morning. I've never been so sure of something in all my life. Simple, simple thing. We're just going to give it to Jesus. We're fixing to hand this to Him. And He's going to take it from you. But it's this simple. We're just going to repeat and we're going to ask Him. I'm just going to lead you in a prayer and you can just repeat this after me. Keep coming if you want to come. If you, you know, come on. Simple prayer. It's not a made up prayer, but we're just going to give it to Him. Right there where you're at, I want you to speak this out of your mouth. I want you to say, Jesus, I give you my fear. I give you the area of my life that has hindered me, that has been a ceiling, that has kept me from being all you've called me to be. Today, I will begin to step into my destiny. I will walk with you. I will enjoy you. I will love you. And I will love others. And so today, I lay this fear at your feet. Jesus, thank you for taking it from me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for paying the price for my sin and for these areas of fear that were put on me. I will never pick it up again. And when I struggle, I will come to you and your word. Father, I just thank you for each and every person here at this altar. And Father, I just thank you that right now, God, there are chains being broken. There's ceilings being taken off. God, right now, in Jesus' name, you're ministering freedom. Lord, we just wait on you this morning. Thank you, God, for bringing freedom. Give him thanks. Just begin to give him thanks. Don't just tell him with your mouth, Jesus, thank you for setting me free. Thank you for touching me. Thank you, Jesus.
Stay here if you would. Others of you that did respond, or all of us, could in our hearts respond. Amen. What an awesome word. Thank you, Breck, for bringing that, sharing your heart with us. As Breck was sharing, amen. Glory to God. I know the feeling. I do it every week. Amen. As Breck was sharing, I thought the Lord spoke two things to me specifically. Out of Psalm 112, it says repeatedly that the righteous will be secure in the Lord. They will have no fear of bad news, and they will have no fear of sudden disaster, that they scatter their gifts freely. In other words, they live with a heart of generosity because they don't struggle with those fears in their heart. The key is the righteous. So what happens when the righteous do struggle? When Breck was sharing about playing football for Oak Grove, and then he gave the disclaimer. But it doesn't deny the fact, just because Oak Grove is much better in football now than they were when Breck played, he's not disqualified from playing. And the scripture says, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off the things that hinder us and the things that slow us down from running the race. And I felt like the Lord was saying, for many of us, we're believers in the Lord, or we're trying to be. But when we struggle, we feel like we have to put the disclaimer on our life. Well, I'm a Christian, but, I love the Lord, but, you know, when I started walking with God and I have these issues in my life and, you know, this happened to me 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 5 years ago, whatever. And we live our life with a disclaimer like that. Well, I played football for Oak Grove, but, you know, the disclaimer is it's not the same Oak Grove. I want you to know that Jesus says that all of those who walked with God before the cross are the same ones who now get to stand in the victory of the cross. They don't have to say, well, you know, I was walking with God before he went to the cross, and I was trying to live my life for Jesus before he proved who he really was. I was trying, struggling in my heart to believe for eternal life before Jesus conquered the grave. And all of us now as New Testament believers get to join with those who were the fathers of faith before us. And Abraham, who believed God and was the first one as the father of faith, and Moses and David in his failures, and everybody else who walked with God, that we don't have to disqualify our lives. We don't have to keep the ceiling there and point to the limit and say, well, you know, this is about as far as I can go with God. And I just hope that you know, when we all get to heaven or whatever, that God says you don't have to put a disclaimer on your life, that fear is not the disclaimer that you constantly have to recognize and point out to other people. Well, you know, I don't want you looking at my life like I'm perfect. Well, if we did that, then you'd be Jesus. We know you're not. But what the enemy wants to do is constantly use that fear in our life to where we have to apologize, to make the disclaimer, to be the exception rather than to be exceptional, and to just step into who God called us to be. Amen. Somebody said that the commandment, do not fear, is in the Bible 365 times. I don't know. I haven't counted. I'm just taking their word for it. But what I do know is that if I struggle with fear every single day of the year, that Jesus is still the same. And confidence is not the absence of fear. You don't have to wait until you're not struggling with whatever that fear is and then say, oh, I'm having a good day. But every day of the year, because of what Jesus has done and who God is, he can tell us, do not fear. We don't have to pick it up again. What I'm telling you this morning is it's not just feeling better because the presence of God was here and we heard a word and we stepped out and we took a risk. But now it's just opening our hearts and asking God to fill all those places that fear used to dwell. The parts of our personality that we've molded around, the aspects of our relationship that we have guided in a certain direction because of fear. Now we give them to the Lord and we let Him fill them, so we walk in confidence in all those things. Can we say amen? Can all of you stand together with us this morning? Those of you that are here, just stay right there if you would. Let's just open our hands to the Lord one more time. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank You for the power of Your Word. God, You watch over Your Word to perform it in our life, that no word of God returns empty, but it accomplishes the purpose for which it's sent. I thank You, Lord, for Your servant this morning. I thank You for Breck. I thank You for his risk and just being vulnerable and being real with us this morning, sharing his own personal struggle, but sharing his victories as well. And Father, I thank You for that witness. I thank You for the testimony. I thank You for the encouragement that we can all find our place and find ourselves in the Word and in the things that He shared. Father, we realize that when we share those things, it's not just us, that the anointing of God, the Holy Spirit, comes upon our life and anoints that word as it goes forth. And Father, You had a specific reason for us being here this morning, whether it's the first time or whether it's just our normal routine and habit and our practice of just coming together because we're part of this body. Lord, we thank You for the word, and we receive it this morning into ourselves. And Father, I pray that the fruit of that word would produce 30, 60, and 100 times what is sown in us. Father, that the fruit of righteousness would overtake areas of our life where the fruit of fear used to dwell and grow. Father, just like weeds out of a garden, that You would just uproot those things and just be more space for the fruit of Your word to produce in our life what You desire for it to. And so, Lord, we thank You for the response. We thank You for a moment where we come and bring to You those things. And Lord, I thank You that we don't pick them up and take them with us when we go, that when we lay them on the altar, it becomes our sacrifice before God. It becomes an act of worship that You take from us and replace it with something so much better, that You replace it with things that bring life, not death. And so, Lord, we receive from You this morning. We thank You for it. We give You praise and glory and honor in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said a confident amen. Everybody said a fear-free amen. Everybody rejoiced in God because He's that good. Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Find somebody around you this morning and encourage them in the Lord, because He is good. What a great word. I receive it. We receive it. Let's live it out in Jesus' name. Bless you, everybody.